Hi. In this video, I'd like to come back to the question that we started in the previous week, which is when and where did the Holocaust take place? And this is really importantly the second part of that story about when and where did the Holocaust take place. And in this second part, we're going to look at the latter war years, and in particular, 1942 to 1945. As a reminder, from what we'd started last week in the video, I said that the Holocaust happened in distinct stages. So between 1938 and 1939, the first stage really was forced emigration. So when the Nazis occupied countries like Austria, they forced the Jews to emigrate and leave. In 1939 to 1941, that changes. And when the Nazis occupy countries like Poland, they start a new different campaign, and that really is about ghettoization, about moving the Jews of those regions into small places in the towns. 1941, things change again, and when the invasion of the Soviet Union happens, the Holocaust by bullets begin, and this is really where the mass murder of the Jews really starts, with the Einsatzgruppen on the front lines in the east killing Jews with bullets. This latter part, though, of the war, which is the bit I really want to focus on today, is really the Holocaust by gas. And 1942 to 1945, again, the nature of the Holocaust changes, and it changes where they start murdering Jews on a massive scale in extermination camps by gas. And it's not really until end of 1941-42 that those extermination camps are built and start. So this is a phenomenon of the second half of the Second World War. So last week, in the last video you looked at, we looked at the Einsatzgruppen. And by the end of 1941, the Einsatzgruppen had murdered around 1 million Jews by bullets. And that figure is really quite horrific when you think about each of these people were killed individually, a million people killed by bullets. But at the same time, the Nazis were also experimenting with different things. And this site here, and this is the remains of the site, this is in occupied Poland. This is a place called Chełmno. And at Chełmno, at the same time that the Einsatzgruppen were on the front killing people with bullets, the Nazis were doing a different experiment here by placing Jews in vans and killing them with exhaust fumes. And the reasons they were doing that is because they were concerned about the SS soldiers and SS officers who were having to do the murdering facing the people they were killing. And that's a really disturbing thing when you think about it, because essentially they changed the nature of the way that they were murdering people because they were worried about the murderers themselves. They're not worried about the victims, they're worried about the people who are doing the murdering. And at Chełmno, they realised that this is a more effective way of removing the Jews. And so, by the autumn of 1941, at the same time that the Einsatzgruppen are in countries like Lithuania and Belarusia, in the autumn of 1941, it's decided in occupied Poland that they are going to exterminate, they're going to murder the Jews of occupied Poland. And this is known as Operation Reinhard, and we are now entering a different phase of the Holocaust. At the same time as this, in January of 1942, outside of Berlin, some leading Nazis meet, and they meet at a lake outside of Berlin called Wannsee. And at Wannsee, there is this mansion. And this is the Wannsee House. It's a beautiful house in a beautiful location. And in January of 1941, a horrific thing happened at this beautiful place. Because in January of 42, leading Nazis sit down and they agree what will become known as the final solution, the murder of the Jews of Europe. And this meeting takes no longer than 90 minutes, and in that 90 minutes, those leading Nazis agree that they are going to kill all of the Jews of Europe. The meeting was led by this man here, Reinhard Heydrich, who we've come across before. He was essentially Himmler's right-hand man in the SS. one of the most disturbing, ideologically driven people in the Nazi regime, and it was him that led the meeting. At the meeting was also Adolf Eichmann. Eichmann was really in charge of the logistics of the final solution. And at that meeting, they kept minutes of the meeting, and these are some. And in these minutes, you will notice that the Nazis actually planned this down to the minute level, and they planned it down to, and they worked out how many Jews were in each country and therefore how many people they were going to kill in total. And you will notice from this bit of paper that they were planning on killing 11 million people in total. You will also notice on this list England, because at this point they were planning that they were going to defeat the English, and as a result, when they invaded England, they would kill the 330,000 Jews that were living in England at the same time. This shows you how brazen this meeting was, how horrific it was. They are planning the extermination of Jews, and they are planning to do that by gas, not by bullets. As a result of this, extermination camps are built in occupied Poland. And you can see them on this map here. So the brown area, sorry, there is the general government. Now, Chelmno is the one we talked about before. Chelmno is the area we've talked about before. But you can also see some other camps that you may have heard of as well. Treblinka, Sobibor, Majdanek, Belzec, and Auschwitz. And all of these are built in 42. So Belzec is built in March of 42. Sobibor in May, Treblinka in July. Chelmno was already there. The most famous of those camps by far though was Auschwitz. Now Auschwitz had actually been a concentration camp already before 1942. That's Auschwitz 1. This site that you can see here is actually a second site. It's also known as Auschwitz 2 or Auschwitz-Birkenau. And this was probably going to become, well, it has become, the most famous extermination camp in history. It's a disturbing site, one that I went to earlier this year. Barren, huge, and this is the railway camp, the railway station as you arrive at that extermination camp. And it was at that camp, at Auschwitz, that they actually tried a new way of killing the Jews. And rather than using exhaust fumes, they used Zyklon B, which you can see the canisters of in this picture here. And Zyklon B was a rat poison. And at Auschwitz 1, they experimented by trapping Jews into a room and chucking in this Zyklon B. It appears as pellets. When you release the pellets from this can, they go into the air and they create poisonous gas, killing people in about 20 minutes. And Zyklon B was horrifically effective, killing vast numbers of people in short periods of time. And it was Zyklon B that they started using at Auschwitz and then actually spread that to other camps. And Jews were brought from all over Europe to these extermination camps. And Auschwitz is the most famous because it being on the western edge, really, meant actually it took most of the Jews from pretty much all over Europe. So Jews that were taken from the Netherlands, from France, from Belgium, from Berlin, from Austria, were all from Hungary, were all taken to Auschwitz-Birkenau to be exterminated. The other camps that you can see that were in occupied Poland were mostly used to exterminate the Jews of Poland, and in particular Treblinka, which has actually similar numbers of people murdered as Auschwitz, really exists just to kill the Jews of Warsaw. But at Auschwitz, you can see that these people would have travelled vast distances to get to this camp. And they were taken to this camp in cattle trucks. So you can see here some Jews queuing up to be taken onto this transport, and in these cattle trucks, which are in essence just wooden boxes, the Jews would have been packed into these trains and taken across Europe, sometimes for days with little water and no toilet facilities and no food. When they arrived at Auschwitz-Birkenau, and this is the train station that's just arrived at Auschwitz-Birkenau, on that platform, they had what they know became known as selection. And at that platform, you can see some of the SS guards right at the bottom here, and doctors, and SS doctors, and they would have walked up and down the line and selected people. Those people who were fit and healthy were sent to the right, and those people would have ended up being worked, and they were worked in slave labor camps, often at the factories that were very nearby. Those people who were put in the left-hand lane, were sent immediately to their deaths. And sometimes at Auschwitz, it took 25 minutes between the time when you arrived and the time that you were murdered. All those people from those trains were murdered in four gas chambers. And the four gas chambers at Auschwitz-Birkenau were pretty much blown apart by the Soviet Union when they invaded in January of 1945. But these are the remains. And in those gas chambers, the Jews would have been asked to take all their clothes off and undress and go inside, where sometimes the gas chambers were made to look like showers. They were locked inside, and then the SS guards from above would pour in the Zyklon B pellets, killing those people. At its height, at Auschwitz alone, 12,000 individuals were murdered every single day. And at Auschwitz alone, 1.1 million in total were murdered at that one individual site. And if you ever get the chance to go there, we're talking about a site that's probably 5, 6, 7 football pitches big. And at that site alone, 1 million people were murdered, which is a really, really disturbing thing. And I said that throughout this story, I wanted to introduce you to individuals. And I want to introduce you to Ziggy Schipper. And Ziggy Schipper is an important individual to introduce you to, because not everybody was killed at Auschwitz. As I said, some people managed to escape and some people managed to leave. And Ziggy was Polish, and by the time he was 15, he'd actually escaped death twice. But in 1944, he was rounded up and he was sent to Auschwitz to Birkenau. And he worked there for a few weeks before being moved to a different concentration camp, because what's odd about this is often Jews were moved around to different concentration camps. And in that different concentration camp in May of 1945, when the British troops liberated it, he was freed. And Ziggy later moved to Britain, and Ziggy has spent his entire life really educating young people about the Holocaust and sharing his story. So it's important we don't just realise that Jews were just killed. Some people did actually manage to escape. Some Jews actively fought and rebelled against the Nazi officers that were trying to commit these horrors. But it's important to remember and memorialise the Holocaust. And this site is the Holocaust Memorial in the middle of Berlin. A site which is known by its official title as the Memorial to the Murdered Jews of Europe. And you need to remember that this is genuinely as one of the worst crimes ever committed by humanity. And 6 million Jews were killed as part of the Holocaust. So over this period of time, over those stages that we've looked at, 6 million individuals are murdered. And it's why it's one of the most important events in history that we need to think about, reflect upon, know about, and remember, because 6 million people lost their lives at the hands of this horrific regime.